Yeah, I'm about to start. No.
Check. All right, jukebox, please. Jukebox. All right, good morning, everybody. About to get this party started. Everybody, welcome to Houston Oasis. We are a community of compassion and reason. We are an alternative to faith-based communities, and behind me, you can see our core values, including people are more important than beliefs, which I have the shirt on right now to prove it. My name is Will, and I will be your MC today. Before I get into our terrific lineup, I want to say a few things that I've noticed recently. I'm really proud of y'all. If y'all don't know, I'm the state director for American Atheists. So I've seen other groups in Texas, and I'm kind of charged with making sure they're healthy, so I kind of know what they're about. I've met the leadership. Houston has something really special going on, because I can compare it to the other cities. Last night, we had a really cool bar night. A lot of new people came in and hung out, and we had just a terrific time. So there's just this influx of energy, which I noticed last night, and I've noticed over the last weeks and months, actually. More new people coming in. People come in early to help. We got set up way earlier than we're used to, which is a terrific problem. So all of this, I just want to give y'all props and say that I'm proud of this community. I'm proud of y'all, and I'm really excited to see where this goes, because it's been going on for 10 years. We just had our 10-year anniversary, and with this energy coming in, I'm nothing but excited about the future of this secular community in Houston and actually beyond. So that's all I want to say. Thank you so much, y'all. Other announcements? I'll say this again later. We have the speaker. He's a terrific dude coming in October 16th, 2 weeks from today. Andrew Seidel. He's a constitutional lawyer, rising star in the secular world. New book just came out on Tuesday. We have advanced copies. They're in the back for sale for $20. They're like $28 out there in the real world, but you get it at a discount because we're awesome like that. And he will be here signing books in 2 weeks. But circle that one on your calendar. It's not to be missed. So now I will announce our awesome lineup for today. Our musicians are Nicole Quinn and Poppy Fields from Austin, Texas. And our main talk is Thomas Westbrook, which I'll introduce him later. So, fresh in from Austin, Texas on a beautiful morning is our Nicole Quinn and Poppy Fields. So give them a hand.
Hey guys, it's good to be back here. I'm gonna start with one by myself. I'm really excited to have Poppy out here with me though. So this is my newest song that I wrote recently. It's called The Loudest Silence. And in a true Nicole Quinn fashion, I have to still read my words and chords because I play like 400 songs and it's hard for me to remember them all.
Well, I didn't even know where to find my mark. The starting gun was fired while I lived in the dark, like a tiny book of matches on a lake of kerosene. You were the fire, the accelerant was me. We lit up the night like,
I'm gonna do that one again.
We lit up the night with stories of our lives, disassembled ourselves, one pain at a time, escaping the fog that consumed us. For a moment we were free, we laughed and then we cried, till the sun broke through the trees. We started with a crash landing. No shield to save us. Free falling through new love. Back to where the darkness reclaimed our hearts. That are broken in between everything we said. All the things we wanted to be. Yesterday I realized that half a year had passed. The spiral was deeper and longer and harder than I ever could have guessed. I hung on the ledge of an unanswered message. I should just let go. But I'm too dumb in love to give up on you. And baby, I still get tripped up on you. We started with a crash landing. No shield to save us. Free falling through the darkness that reclaimed our hearts. That are broken in between all the words that went unsaid and everything we wanted to be. I said that I'm sorry, I wanted to hear you. You gave me nothing in return, but something goes there, but I don't remember because you left my heart with a third degree burn. You started with a crash landing. No shield to save us. Free falling through new love to where the darkness reclaimed our hearts. And everything that went unsaid and everything we wanted to be. I don't know why that sounds that way. There, we're ended it right there. I'm gonna invite Poppy up here on the stage with me. I really like to come and play my new songs for you guys. I'm gonna tune up a little bit here. Y'all are always a great great crowd to test the new ones out on.
Hi, I'm Poppy. I'm very grateful to be here. I'm gonna go with the crash vibe, and I'm playing a song called Crash Like Waves.
I've got a new perspective. I'm changing so drastically. I can finally see in front of me. Time is an illusion, and it rips away what seems easy. Crash like waves at our knees, and we wouldn't even see it coming. They said stop and smell the roses, but what if they're fasted in a winter dream? I won't cry a tear. They're like ice, you see, just floating on a moving stream. And it could all melt like spring off the leaves, and we wouldn't even miss a thing. Thank you. When I'm face down on the shore, I'm cold in the wind.
Thank you so much, y'all. They're going to play a few more tunes for us later in the morning. You can follow their adventures on the Instagrams and I think all the social media. Their handles are SongbirdATX and Green-Eyed Poppy. Awesome names. Now, I am going to introduce our main speaker. He'll give the talk, and then we'll have a coffee break, and then we can have some Q&A afterwards. So think about the Q&As as the talk is going and over some coffee and conversation with friends. But our main speaker, we are excited to have, is Mr. Thomas Westbrook. He will discuss everything you should have learned in science class but didn't. He was raised as an evangelical Christian missionary kid in the Muslim world, Central Asia / Soviet country, I believe. Later, he created a YouTube channel called Holy Koolaid. And using scientific skepticism and critical thinking to describe the process of his deconversion. He also hosts a yearly, semi-yearly conference called the Faithless Forum, which you can find around Texas. Keep an eye out for that. So without further ado, our main speaker is Mr. Thomas Westbrook.
Can you guys hear me? Awesome. I'm really excited to be here. I've attended a couple of Oasises before. What's the plural of Oasis? Oases? I've been to a few Oases before, but this is the first one that I'm actually talking at, so I'm very excited about it. Is it working? Okay, I'll make sure not to block you guys' view. The most fun part about all of these things is the technical difficulties. Today I want to talk about everything that we should have learned in science class, but didn't. How many of you guys had a crummy science education? Where maybe you were taught that humans and dinosaurs coexisted together, that the Earth was 6,000 years old, that it all popped into existence in 6 days, or maybe you were taught that there was a giant global flood that happened about 4,000 years ago and wiped out everything on Earth, and evolution is a lie, and scientists are lying to you in order to live a life of sin. That's basically what I was taught growing up. Here in the heart of the Bible Belt, I'm sure that it's not too uncommon for you guys to have heard a similar story. But after going to college and learning a little bit more about how the scientific process worked, I realized I needed to re-examine a lot of my beliefs. But in doing so, I discovered that it's not just young Earth creationists who have a very rudimentary understanding of science, because science is extremely complicated. That's what I thought history looked like. How many of you guys learned in high school this basic notion of kind of the six-step process of what the scientific method is? You make an observation. You formulate a question, take that question, turn it into a hypothesis, perform an experiment on it, analyze everything, and then come up with a conclusion or a result. You guys familiar with this? Congratulations, you have just caught up to 1265, which is when the scientific method was first proposed at actually testing to see how the world works. This is not bad, it's just incomplete. Not even incomplete, it's incompla. So what I want to do is I want to walk through the different steps and go a little bit more in depth as to how they work, because right now, if you just have this, it's very surface level, and it doesn't really protect you against bad ideas. It doesn't really help you to tell fact from fiction because there's so much more to it, and there's so many ways that it can go astray if we're not careful. The first part, the experiment, the dreaded experiment. We've all seen people, you know, take two different chemicals and pour them into a beaker and they change colors, or, you know, maybe you have a volcano that erupts or something. We think like chemistry. But an experiment is such a broad term. It's just a way of testing to see if one thing might cause another result, see how the world works, and there's a lot of steps that go into making for a good experiment. The first is use of controls. So if I take something and there's a million different things that can change, a million different variables, and I'm just randomly throwing spaghetti at the wall and seeing what the result is, I'm not gonna get good information out of that. But if I take, let's say that I'm testing for whether or not a particular medical pill cures cancer or cures Alzheimer's or any other thing. If let's say that I have that pill and, you know, I'm like, okay, I wanna know, does this work? If I'm performing half the tests on lab rats and a bunch on humans and a bunch on monkeys, and some of them I try one chemical and some I try another and it's all jumbled up, I'm not gonna get good results. But if I keep everything consistent, I keep everything controlled or the same except for one variable, then I might be able to see, like, interesting, when I change that one variable, I get this one result. You need to have a large enough sample size. The sample size, basically, that means like all the people that you're experimenting on, or all the, you know, animals or whatever that you're experimenting on. If you just randomly, like, let's say that I perform an experiment on two people, and I'm trying to see if maybe your cell phone causes cancer. Well, if I perform it on two people and one of them happens to be a lifelong smoker, and that person doesn't use a cell phone, or that person does use a cell phone and gets cancer, I might draw shoddy conclusions based off of that result. And so you need to look at a larger sample size. You need to look at hundreds, thousands, tens of thousands of people potentially in order to actually get good data. You also need that sample to be randomized. If you have tens of thousands of people, but unless it's intentionally studying one specific focus group, if I don't randomize the group, maybe my bias might play into it. I might have one group that I'm like, we'll put, you know, 90% guys in this group and 10% girls, and that might skew the results. You want it to be as random and as similar in the different groups that you're testing as possible. You also want to test against a placebo. So especially with clinical trials, if you're trying to see if something actually does what you think it might do, if you give someone a sugar pill or, you know, give them water or something or inject them with a saline solution and they think that they're getting medicine, sometimes your body actually responds to that. You might actually have a psychosomatic response where you think that the medicine is doing more, and depending on the condition, sometimes your body can actually respond because your brain is physical, your brain is made of chemicals, and when it releases those chemicals, it can actually physically alter through chemistry your body's response to something. And so in order to see if something actually works better than a placebo, better than a sugar pill, because a lot of these things that, you know, medical trials, you might be testing on something that may have negative side effects. And if it doesn't work any better than water, then the cost reward is kind of skewed. You also want to make sure when you're testing against a placebo that you're doing a double-blind test, because sometimes our own biases can skew the experiment. So let's say that I am looking at two different groups and one is given a placebo and one is not, but I know who's getting the placebo and the person receiving it knows who's getting the placebo and who's not. Just that knowledge alone can affect the results of the experiment. So what you want is to have a well-structured experiment where neither the experimenter nor the person being experimented on knows which one is the placebo and which one isn't. And then once you take that, you might have them like numbered or labeled a particular way, and then you can look at the data at a kind of bird's eye view and analyze the results that way. And a good experiment needs to be replicable. A famous experiment that was not replicable but could have had earth-shattering results was one called the Fleischmann-Pons experiments. And it basically, in the early 90s, the holy grail in physics or in renewable energy would be something called cold fusion. In the sun, you have a fusion reaction that's going on, but it's extremely hot. It's a nuclear reaction, and it releases a ton of energy, like a tremendous amount of energy. If we could harness that, all of our energy problems would be gone. But that's an extremely hot process. And so the notion that, hey, maybe we could do that colder, that's a pretty big deal. Well, Fleischmann and Pons created an experiment. They released the results. They published the results. They're like, look, we did it. The only problem is no one was able to replicate the results. They weren't able to replicate the results. So is it really a good experiment, or was there a fluke? Was there something corrupt in the data? I want to kind of pull you guys real quick on a couple of different things in the scientific process to see, maybe to prove a point. First of all, when do you think that the first academic journals were published? The first academic journals were published in 1665. What about the first placebo tests? Throw numbers out. Someone, anyone. 1800s. 1700s. 19, mid 19, early 19. 1937. It's a lot later than I thought when I was like looking at the history of science. It wasn't literally until the 20th century that people started doing placebo testing. What about controlled experiments where you actually are isolating everything except for one thing that's changing? First controlled experiments. This one's a little bit earlier, 1753. But it's kind of crucial to the scientific process, so the fact that it's only been around for a couple hundred years should tell you something. Double-blind testing. When do you think the first publication that basically performed an experiment based off of double-blind testing, what year do you think that was? 60s? Anyone else? 1950. It wasn't until the 1950s that double-blind testing became a thing. These are crucial things. These are things that, like, when we think of whether or not a scientific experiment is good or not, it's only literally in my parents' lifetime that this stuff started to be implemented. That's nuts. So you have to realize that a lot of the stuff that within science, you'll hear things like, oh, you know, science is constantly changing. That's a good thing. It's getting better. We're learning how to weed out the bad data in order to find the good. There's a few things when analyzing the results of your experiment that you have to also be conscious of. So we looked at the experiment. Now we're looking at analysis of the results. You got to realize that correlation doesn't equal causation. It's kind of the golden rule of statistics. Most of you have probably heard this before. I'll illustrate it with one chart. Ice cream sales versus shark attacks. Apparently, as ice cream sales go up, shark attacks also go up, and as they go down, they go down. So therefore, we shouldn't eat ice cream because people die from shark attacks. Obviously an erroneous conclusion to draw. There's no connection whatsoever. In fact, there's actually a third variable that affects both of them. In the summertime, people eat more ice cream. In the summertime, people also go swimming more. They're more likely to be attacked by sharks. Sometimes, when you're looking at and analyzing your results, there might be a third variable. Sometimes they might not be connected at all, and it just looks like there's a correlation. Doesn't mean that one caused the other. Now, there are ways to kind of parse out the data to figure out if something is causal, you know, to do a multivariant analysis. But it's just, it's incredibly important to realize that just because two things seem to be are correlated or seem to be connected doesn't mean one caused the other. Correlation equal causation. I mentioned briefly multivariate analyses. Don't have too much time to get much more into that, but I want to move on to looking at results. Now that you've gathered the data, now that you've analyzed the data, it needs to be replicable. I stress that point all the time, or I stressed it earlier, and it also needs to be published. Why? Why does publication matter? Why is it such a big deal? Anyone? Peer review. Also, accessibility. If everyone is performing science in a vacuum and everyone is starting from scratch, reinventing the wheel every time, and no one has access to each other's results, progress is going to stagnate. You want to be able to access other people's results and their data and to be able to learn from it and grow from it. And you also want to be able to review it. So if I publish a result, there's a chance I might make mistakes. There's a chance that I might misinterpret the data, or I might fall for any of the things, you know, in the experiment that I was just going over, problems or things that make for a bad experiment. But who exactly are these peers? Is it Ken Ham of Answers in Genesis? Is it your friends? When we hear peer, we think like, oh, our colleagues. No, it's none of that. A peer, when you think of an academic journal, when someone peer reviews the journal, it's basically experts in the field that are not chosen by you. You don't submit it to your friend to take a look at it. You submit it to a respectable academic journal to be published, and they choose experts in the relevant field to review the results. So if I'm performing an experiment that's in the field of geology, I'm not going to submit that for peer review to a astrophysicist or a chemist or a medical doctor. It has to be someone that has the relevant expertise to the specific area. Now, there might be an aspect of the experiment that involves chemistry, and you might have a collaboration between different fields. That's different. But your peers, the peers, not your peers, necessarily. Not all academic journals are created equal. Here we have on the left side the journal Nature, which is a well-respected journal, and we have the Journal of Creation, which is not a well-respected journal. And I'll show you why. There are a few telltale signs to spot a good versus a bad journal. This is the ARC Journal of Pharmaceutical Sciences. Legitimate or illegitimate? Good journal or bad journal? What do you think? Sounds good. Looks good. It uses science-y terms. And yet, why on earth was it that this journal published an article based off of the show Rick and Morty, talking about the ways that basically a scientist was trying to show what a good journal versus a bad journal, what the practices would be, and they submitted for publication a journal talking about the ways you can protect against these parasitic alien brain slugs. And the journal published it. The name of the article was Newer Tools to Fight Intergalactic Parasites and Their Transmissibility in Zygerion Simulation. Now, they're not the only ones, because there are a lot of journals out there that are pay to play. They're predatory journals. What they will do is they will message a ton of different scientists, a ton of different people, professors in academia, and they'll say, hey, if you just pay us $500 or $1,000, we'll publish your work. Only problem is you work for who pays you. And so as long as they get the paycheck, they don't mind publishing whatever the heck people send them. And so basically the professors and scientists, if they pay them enough money, they'll publish anything. A good example of this is this journal right here, the International Journal of Advanced Computer Technology. Sounds legitimate. Great sciencey terms. They sent out a request, you know, does anyone want to have their journal published? And one scientist was so fed up with getting bombarded by these spam requests from predatory journals that he submitted a paper titled, Get Me Off Your Fucking Mailing List, where every single word of the abstract is just copy-paste over and over and over again, get me off your effing mailing list. It came complete with charts, scatter plots, a summary, and a conclusion. Do you know what the conclusion of the paper was? Get me off your effing mailing list. Now, the difference between a predatory journal and a good, reliable academic journal is that a good journal isn't pay to publish, they are subscription based. So there are thousands of universities around the world that are looking for, desperate for good research. And so a good journal wants to keep their academic standards high. They want to keep it rigorous. They want to make sure that nothing slips through the cracks that's not good, and when it's bad, they retract the articles. It's transparent, but because they're making their money from institutions that are subscribing to them, then there's pressure for them to release good results rather than just publishing whatever people pay to publish them. How do you find a good academic journal? Well, first off, how do you spot a bad one? This is in no ways a comprehensive list, but there is a tool you can use called Bell's List, which basically is a collection of potentially predatory journals and publishers. If you type in a journal into this list and it comes up, it's probably a pretty bad sign. There's also a tool called the Master Journals List, which I believe is this slide. If you go into Google and you just Google search for Master Journals List, then there is basically a list of thousands of journals that are, like, any university, any reputable university subscribing to a journal is gonna pull from this list. And they make sure that the standards are up to par. There's also, if you wanna see the impact of a particular journal, because one might be, okay, they published this, but it's so obscure and it's not really anything that people in the field are talking about, may or may not mean that it's reputable, but it's at least not making waves. You look at a journal's impact factor. So a really good journal like Nature or Science is gonna have a higher impact factor, which is measuring how much their articles are being cited by other journals. And so it's like, okay, hey, this is something that it's reputable enough in the field that it has a decent impact factor score. So you've made an experiment. You have gone through this whole process of forming a question, forming a hypothesis, experimenting on it, looking at the, or analyzing the results and coming up with a conclusion. Now, you have to realize that all theories must go through this process for it to be a good experiment. But when you're drawing the conclusion, it has to fit the data. If I'm coming up with the conclusion at the very end, I've looked at all this stuff, I've gone through all these steps, and I'm like, all right, and now the result is this, and the data says something entirely different, well, I didn't science very well. It also needs to have explanatory power. So if I come up with a good hypothesis based off of all of my results, and it doesn't really explain anything, it's not a good theory. Like, a theory is a way of asking, like, why are the results this way? Why is this happening? Why are things going like this? So you have to be able to explain it. You need to be able to make predictions off of it, because once it has explanatory power and it fits the data thus far, and you make a prediction for the next experiment, you're able to iterate and see, is this going somewhere? Is this good? I want to cover a couple of science myths and misconceptions real quick before I run out of time. How much do I get a time notification when I get close? Got, I think, about 7 minutes. The first myth that I want to talk about is this notion that science is a body of knowledge. It is not. It is that process that we looked through. It is that recurring, self-correcting, self-improving process that we do that is never perfect. And that's okay. When you realize that everyone is a little bit flawed, people have imperfect perceptions, people make mistakes, but the more eyes are on something and the more we improve this process, even though it's fallible, that's okay. Because every time we fall a little bit closer and a little bit closer and get a little bit closer to figuring out how the world works, to mitigating harm, and to creating a world based off of facts. Science is a process. It's not a collection of books. It's not a collection of knowledge that's hiding in an ivory tower somewhere, safeguarded by a bunch of people in some conspiracy thing. When a long-standing theory is replaced, it's replaced with a new one based on new information. It's because the current theory is falsified and a new theory is not. It doesn't shift backwards to an already falsified idea. I can't stress this enough. I can't tell you how many times I've seen or heard people take a particular idea that's already been debunked 20 times over, like the flat earth theory, which it's not, or they will look at like Galen's idea of the four humors in medicine. It was like, oh, instead of it being germs that make you sick, it's that all your fluids are all out of whack. So maybe you have too much blood and we should do bloodletting, or your bile is a little bit off. And so we just gotta tweak the fluids in your body. That was a really, really, really bad hypothesis. And it was debunked and it was proven wrong using the scientific process. So if all of a sudden we realize that, you know what, there's more to it than just germs, there's like something else or something additional because we get more information, all of a sudden we have a new data point to add to the thousands of others. And so if you have this other theory that doesn't fit any of that data, you don't go back to reinstate something that's already been proven wrong 1,000 times over. You tweak what you have and come up with something new, something more accurate, something better. The other idea is that science opposes change. That it is, there are these inquisitions for, you know, she's science strong, so burn them at the stake. There are people in science who, there are scientists who are stubborn and obstinate, who will drag their feet, absolutely. But the whole purpose of the scientific method, the entire purpose, the whole reason that it exists, is to change, to grow. That's why there are Nobel Prizes that are given to people who come along and overturn theories that have stood for hundreds of years and prove that they're wrong. And it, when that happens, it's celebrated. Rather than it being this horrible catastrophe that people are never going to be able to recover from, that is an accomplishment. That is the entire point of science. Then there's the notion of the lone rogue genius. We've all seen this. Rick and Morty, Professor Farnsworth from Futurama, Back to the Future. Yeah. So there's this idea that there's just one person who's moving science forward. It's Albert Einstein, or it's Thomas Edison, and after they die, oh no, Nikola Tesla, after they die, the whole world will never be able to be the same. In actuality, there are tens of thousands of these, hundreds of thousands of these, all around the world that are working on the same problems, advancing it together, collaborating in teams. You will very rarely see a earth-shattering paper that doesn't have a bunch of names on the bottom of it. Also, if someone is incredibly smart, sometimes you'll see these people selling alternative medicine or claiming that they have some special information or knowledge that people in science just don't want you to know, or that this person is this lone genius. If someone is really that intelligent, where they're able to just know facts instantly and memorize things and just flip through books and just get it and grasp it, those people get something called full ride scholarships. They can have their way paid for them. They can get grants. They can have their research paid for them to do. And they don't have to be in some basement publishing some book to a bunch of like followers on the internet. And even if they don't go the university route, they still can publish their work to academic journals for peer review, to check and see if there's actually something to this, to see if other people can replicate the results. So this idea that there's just some lone genius out there that's pushing science forward, or a bunch of lone geniuses, it's not really how science works. There's also the idea that scientific consensus is groupthink, and I don't have a lot more time, but scientific consensus is one of the most important things as a layperson that you have to rely on. I don't mean that just because a lot of people believe in something, it's true. That's an appeal to popularity, or what's the name of the fallacy? There's a couple different names for it, but basically, just because a bunch of people believe something doesn't mean it's true. But in science, when you get experts who have been spending decades in particular fields, and there are thousands of them, or hundreds of thousands of them, in thousands of different institutions, there may be some minority positions, there may be some disagreement, but overall, with things that have a strong consensus, where there's really good reason why everyone holds to a particular idea, a particular belief, germs cause disease, for example, even if you don't know that field very well, even if you're not very knowledgeable about that field, all of us have to rely to some extent on expertise. We have to trust some level of, okay, someone has done the work, someone has put in the time, someone has gone through the process. I don't have enough time in the world to get a PhD in every single field, so I trust the consensus. It's not one lone scientist, it's not one person going against the grain, it's looking at the consensus and saying there's value in this process, and there's probably a good reason why so many people hold to a particular position. That doesn't mean it's groupthink, where if you go against the grain, you're cut out and you're ostracized. Like I said, it's changing. Being able to push science forward is encouraged, and proving things wrong, if you can do it, there are prizes waiting for you. So how can you tell what the consensus is? Well, in order to determine it, one great way is textbooks, entry-level textbooks. They'll typically, in graduate level in different fields, they might have a state of the field paper where a graduate student will publish what are the current consensuses, consensus on a particular issue. And they'll publish and they're like, okay, here's where people stand and why. And because science is constantly progressing and moving forward, then that's gonna change a little bit from year to year. But if you get a textbook, an entry-level textbook that's up to date, basically, it's a academically published state of the field paper. In a way, it's saying, hey, here's all these different positions and why people hold them. There's also organizations out there, like the Center for Inquiry, that has a collaboration of a bunch of scientists, and they'll publish magazines like Skeptical Inquirer, examining these claims from potential snake oil salesmen, from people who are trying to empty your wallet and, you know, make off rich. And having these watchdog organizations that are led by scientists in different fields is a really useful tool to have. But how do you change the consensus? This process. Every scientific theory has to go through this process. And the beautiful thing is, we can all be a part of it. Small or big changes, we can all dive in and figure out how the world works. Because somewhere, something incredible is waiting to be known. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Thomas. Thank you. So dinosaurs and humans did or did not coexist? I don't think you ever cleared that up. Did not? Okay, all right. But thank you for advocating for the scientific consensus. That's a huge thing. So keep doing that, please. Before I let you all out for the coffee break, I want to give you a quick announcement and to everyone watching online as well. 2018, Hurricane Harvey came through and really gave us a hurtin' here in Houston. And we had a lot of support from the Oasis Network, different Oases around the country. So it is our turn to help now. Hurricane Ian went through Florida and really messed them up. So we have a chapter called North Orlando Oasis, and full of good people just like here. And they need our help. Yeah, we're gonna post something on the private Facebook page and on our website as far as how you can help. But there's Central Florida Mutual Aid that you can send money to. We are amassing some supplies and things physically to send over there. So if you wanna help with our local efforts, you can donate money specifically for that. There's gonna be a link online that you can donate, again, specifically for this, to give them some relief. You can talk to our treasurer, Richard, back there with the hat, and he can earmark it specifically for that purpose. So I'll bring it up again later at the very end, but I just wanted to tell the folks online and have you all mull over it. So enjoy the coffee break, 10, 15 minutes. We'll start, come back with some Q&A, meet some new people. Y'all online, go get some coffee. Maybe look up these links that we're gonna post, and we'll see you back here in a bit.
Thank you. If I had no food, I think my mom was wrong to stay with dad so painfully long. Then again, daddy, well, he never was that strong. And that's just the way it goes. Sometimes I think my sister should have found a man guess she's done the very best she can. Maybe that kind of love was never in her plan. And that's just the way it goes. Someday I hope my son comes to believe that it wasn't my idea that his mom and he should leave. Hope he knows we never meant for his tiny heart to grieve. That's just the way it goes. Write funny songs to cover up the pain. Hide from the losses that I just can't explain. And I, poor little man, but I'm never quite insane. That's just the way it goes. That's just the way it goes. Sometimes I think the pain we feel to another soul cannot be real. And again, the pain unfelt never really healed. And that's just the way it goes. Sometimes I think our hearts never
check.
Do repair.
Check.
Though we've got a friend or two who tell us that they care.
All right, y'all. Awesome coffee break. That was terrific. I love it. And now it is time to have a Q&A session, and we're going to get this second half started with another tune from Nicole Quinn and Poppy Fields.
But it's all we've got.
Start thinking of some Q&As. The Qs.
Welcome back.
Hey, guys. I think I'm going to need to see that paper on the intergalactic parasites. I think that's relevant to my interests. No, I'm really glad that we have people doing science stuff because I don't. So there's glad there's people out there. All right, we're gonna do one of Poppy's songs together.
And the song is called Slipping on Ice.
Wrong time, it's not cold. Maybe I'm just getting old. Hold on. Why is there ice on the ground? Where's your shoes? What's up with these lights? Wake up and smell the coffee. It's hot, but not hotter than outside.
night I lost my clothes. Ooh, ooh, ooh. I'm dying before I lost my mind. Can you help me find? I checked under the couch till I have no relief. You see, I set my issues down wherever I please. If you cut it down once, you can cut it till it bleeds. Just a lie in your face, this is not what it seems. Where the fuck are your keys? Have you eaten and weeds? Do you feel? Are you able to breathe? Do you feel yourself falling forward and back? Where do you get yourself now? What do you try to push faster?
To. Well, we're going to that was our Q&A session. So we have Thomas come up here and do the A portion. The Qs come from here. We have Jacob over there and Terry with the microphone. So they're going to be walking around and separating in half. So raise your hand if you have a Q and we'll get this A's going.
See a question right there.
Good morning. This is a very interesting presentation, and it made it very interesting because sometimes when people present science stuff, it can be very dry and very boring and lose a lot of lay people. Okay, before I answer this, I ask this question, I'm going to go ahead and out myself so nobody gets any misconceptions. As of yesterday afternoon, I am quadruple vaxxed. I have my fourth.
Can you speak up a little bit?
Yes, as of yesterday afternoon, I am quadruple vaxxed COVID, and I've had my, I've also had my flu shot at one visit. And I want to talk about scientific consensus, you know, COVID and social media and YouTube. Mm. My impression was that before COVID hit, with Darwinian evolution, global warming, which it's long been established, just like a 97, 98, 99 consensus that those things are real, I would see stuff on YouTube, see stuff on Twitter and Facebook questioning those, despite the fact that there was extreme, you know, a hardcore consensus and anti-LGBTQ stuff, and there was no attempts to take any of that down, despite the fact that I think they were a little bit loony-toony. But with my impression with COVID is that it was such a new thing, and the impression is because it was such a new thing, there wasn't as much ironclad scientific consensus as there was with evolution of global warming. And there was like this, instead of just letting letting some of this information get out there so we can kind of discuss it, there was like a huge effort to shut down a lot of stuff that was, I wish it was some gray, which they dubbed misinformation. And also, 2 years ago, Dr. Jay Bhattacharya out of Stanford and Dr. Martin Koldov came out with a great Barrington Declaration, which basically says in alternative lockdowns, we do focus protection, protect the vulnerable. And they have a more nuanced view about the vaccines, but they didn't buy into the huge conspiracies.
So what's the question?
Okay, so the question is, okay, so there was a huge, trying to do a huge takedown. I want to get your thoughts on allowing scientific debate, as particularly something new, rather than, you know, trying to censor and ruin the careers of people who probably have some valid points and valid research to bring to the table, the way Fauci and Dr. Collins tried to.
Yeah, so when it comes to all the stuff surrounding COVID and the COVID vaccines, when you say that they were shut down or that they were censored and not allowed to talk, are you talking about the scientific platforms, or are you talking about social media and Facebook? Because those are two very different things. So, you know, anything, I was talking to someone just a second ago over there about how I would not want to be in a scientific field where the public eye and everyone's uneducated opinions are just being thrown around on something with the spotlight that happened during COVID. Because when you have a new virus that, yeah, scientists know a lot about viruses, they know a fair amount about coronaviruses even. But this was something that was new and was different. I'm not a scientist. I don't want to speak outside of what I know. But what I did see was a lot of opinions being thrown around that weren't grounded in even basic rudimentary science of what we do know. So there were some things that were new that, yes, there should be discussion. They should be looking into it. And I think because there was such an intense debate surrounding things that were nonsense, like, oh, is there a tracking chip in it that Bill Gates is putting in there to, you know, this is the mark of the beast and stuff. There was so much of that stuff that was fear-mongering that I saw people basically just getting frustrated to the point where they're just like, just cut it off, which isn't good. I think there should be open debate and dialogue, and there should be discussion, but I understand the frustration from people who are like in the trenches, in the field, learning this stuff, and it's like, it's not their job to get on social media and whack down every single loony conspiracy, or even not loony conspiracy, but legitimate ideas that maybe they've already done the work and already examined and already know. The short answer is it was a mess. The long answer is yes, I think that there should be dialogue, but not every idea is created equal. Over mic's over there. Here.
Thank you. My statement on COVID is that we have public health standards for any kind of pandemics, you know, in the past, whether it was polio or other things. And I think what we didn't emphasize enough, possibly, and I'd like your opinion on this, is that there are basic public health practices that go into place when you know you have something that's highly contagious. And nobody, you know, these people that were on other tracks wanted to ignore that. What's your thought about that?
What specific, like how do you phrase that in a question?
Do you feel that public health standards were followed throughout this coronavirus pandemic in terms of isolating, you know, the sensible approach to wearing masks until we knew more because of past types of, you know, communicable?
Yes and no. It depends on by who. Followed by the general public, put in place by state governments, local governments. Like, it was all over the place. So, and again, I hate to, you know, talk as an expert or something, because I'm not. But what I did see is that you had, you know, one state or local government following one set of ideas or one strategy, and others following something completely different, and half the population not listening to the guidelines of either. So, no, I don't think that it was followed in the way. Now, were the guidelines that were put out by, like, the CDC, were those based off of what we knew about past communicable diseases? From what I've seen, yes. But again, this is one of those things that, like, we could focus on one thing after, like, there's a lot of different things, like the masks, the vaccines, the social distancing, how much space is needed. Like, you could focus on each one and talk about those individually. How many people should be in a room? You know, I don't know if there is a perfect answer for, like, what is the right number? What is the right cap? What is the exact perfect amount of space? I don't know. But I didn't see people actually taking it seriously enough to listen to the guidelines that were put out by people who did know a little bit more about how pandemics work. Yes?
Hi. This is the question I asked you in the coffee line that you said I should ask now. Following up on the state of the scientific consensus, how good are popular magazines like Discover, Scientific American, even the science section of your local newspaper or the national newspaper about summarizing and stating the state of the scientific consensus in any particular
field? How reliable are PopSci magazines?
Exactly.
Obviously, it's going to vary from one to the next, but horrible. Abysmal, even sometimes. Not all of them are that bad. Sometimes, like, they'll put out stuff that's, it's good, it's spot on. I would always encourage people, though, to actually click on the studies that they're citing, and if it's a good one and it's a reliable one, they will cite the sources. But just go and click and, like, take 2 seconds to just read the abstract. You don't even have to read the entire paper. Just read, like, the paragraph-long abstract that says what was the experiment and what were the results. Because a lot of times what these journals will do, well, not journals, but, like, popular science magazines will do, is they'll take one thing that's barely mentioned and they'll, like, twist it to this extreme end result. An example I'll give you is, how many of you guys have seen those headlines that'll say things like, red wine might cure cancer or prevent cancer? It's like, wow, that's a pretty big breakthrough. I'm never gonna be sober again in my life. But then you click on the study that it's citing, and it's like, okay, there's one chemical, resveratrol, that, like, when they heavily concentrated it and tested it on lab rats, then they saw, like, a certain decrease in a certain amount of cellular damage that is a suspect in certain types of cancer. That's a big difference from red wine cures cancer, because one, just because something happens in rats doesn't mean it works in humans. Humans are not rats. They're genetically similar enough that we can test certain things and test, you know, safety and efficacy to a certain extent. But there's a reason why you have to have human trials in order to tell if something works for humans. The other thing is, one chemical having a particular result, it's like, okay, even if this chemical is able to kill cancer cells, you know what else kills cancer cells? A 12-gauge shotgun. But you probably don't want to use that to kill your cancer. It's one of those things that headlines are their sole purpose is to generate clicks, because a lot of these journals, they're based off of an ad revenue model, where the more people that click on the article and read through the article, the more ads that they're shown, the more money that they make, and the more they can grow and put out more articles. So the ones that are doing the super clickbaity headlines, red wine cures cancer, they're gonna get clicks, they're gonna get shares, and a lot of times people will share them without even reading the PopSci blog, much less clicking on the link and seeing what actually the result was.
Thank you for being a spokesperson for science. It sounds as if you, from your upbringing, you weren't originally. And can you say a few words about how you came to be such a firm believer in science?
So, my education all the way through high school was, like I said, young earth creationism. I don't know if you guys are familiar with A. Becca or Bob Jones, Pensacola University. Their curriculum, they put out homeschool material that literally, God, I don't know the numbers, but it's massive. Homeschoolers all around the world use this stuff. And it's very pseudoscientific, extremely pseudoscientific. It wasn't until I got to college that I started to dig a little bit deeper. And I had all of my roommates were engineers and were super into science and learning and watching TED Talks and stuff. So that kind of whet my appetite. I was always interested in learning how the world worked and how the mind worked and psychology and all this stuff. And then when I started to dive more into that, I began learning how evolution actually works, what natural selection actually is, that it's not a purely random process. And as I began to understand it, and then I started getting the evidence for it and started seeing all the signs that it's not just like one line of evidence, but it's like a Venn diagram where you have thousands of different fields that are, well, not thousands of fields, but tons of fields and thousands of pieces of data that are all converging on this one theory, and that a theory is not just a hunch, a theory is not just a hypothesis, a theory doesn't go, like, you will never go from hypothesis to theory to scientific fact. There's no such thing. That's not how the process works. A theory is trying to explain why something works the way that it is. And a scientific law is like, okay, when you drop something, it falls at this rate or something. There's a difference between the theory of gravity and the law of gravity. You'll never have it, something go from being a theory to being a law. And when I took my shoddy understanding of evolution as, oh, it's just this hunch, this theory that scientists, they just want to live a life of sin, and so they put forward this nonsense in life or the devil. And when I actually examined it and realized that there's a reason why there's this consensus. And not just that, but when I watched debates between scientists and like creationists who claim they were scientists, I saw a lot of dishonesty, particularly in a debate between Ken Ham and Bill Nye, where they were both asked a question, what would it take to change your mind? Bill Nye said, one piece of evidence, I want to go where the data leads, I'm willing to go wherever the truth is. And Ken Ham's response was, nothing is ever going to convince me that the Bible isn't the perfect word of God. In that moment, it instantly told me that you are not dealing with two intellectually honest people. And so that was kind of my process of shifting out of it. And then over the years since then, I've taken a lot of online courses, science courses. You can find MOOCs or massive open online courses from everywhere, from MIT, Harvard, Yale, Berkeley, Cambridge, you name it, that will teach you really good courses on things like physics and chemistry or even archaeology if you're interested in it. And they're completely free. You don't get college course credit for it, but you can learn. And you can find books that are taking these topics that experts will dilute down a little bit for the public to understand. People like Neil deGrasse Tyson, Brian Greene, Sean Carroll, they'll write these books that they are physicists, they are experts in these areas, but they're communicating it in a way that the public can understand without going the PopSci route, or the PopSci journals or magazine route. Does that kind of answer those long-winded? But any other, do we have time? Where? Oh, right there.
About 4 miles from here, in a giant converted basketball stadium, thousands of people are listening to a TV preacher. I would bet that none of them have received education featuring logic, skepticality, or scientific thinking. And they don't watch your videos. In a democracy, we have a lot of people who cannot determine fact from fiction, and they elect our political officials. For decades, I've been trying to figure out how to educate religious people and then have them become free thinkers. Do you have any strategies that could enlighten this larger audience?
Excellent question. What strategies would I take to push back against religious fundamentalism and educate people in science? That is literally what I do full time as a job. Is I make videos, I make YouTube videos, and I'll take complex topics, I'll condense them down, and I push back against religious fundamentalism. So right now, I'm doing a series on faith healing and debunking faith healers. Now, for me, I take more of an educational approach where I want the resources to be out there and available, and I know not everyone can do that because not everyone knows how to edit video and not everyone knows how to put together a story in that way. But I think that all of us should be speaking out, whether it is a one-on-one conversation with someone, whether it is writing blog posts and then sharing them, not just writing them to exist in the internet somewhere, but actually going on social media and sharing the content with people and with in different groups and having discussions. One-on-one debates, I don't find changes the mind of the person who you're debating with pretty much ever. And the reason that I say that is because when you hold to an idea emotionally, even if you come up against facts, a lot of times there's a backfire effect where you double down on your belief system. And I like to see it as if your beliefs are, let's say that I have a quiver full of arrows as an analogy, and the quiver is kind of my identity, and then the beliefs are arrows that I can swap in and out. If instead I make the beliefs part of my identity, I cannot swap out my belief system without having an identity crisis. And so you have to realize that the people that were, whose minds were hoping to change, it's their entire identity that's attached to it. And so it does take compassion, handling it with kid gloves, not treating people like they're stupid, instead of coming up against them like me versus you butting heads, maybe take it as less of a confrontational thing and more of like a collaborative, I wanna go wherever the truth leads, I believe that you do too. Truth withstands scrutiny, so we shouldn't be afraid to scrutinize anything. Let's take this, treat this as a journey that we're on together, and let's figure it out. And I'm willing to change my mind, like, are you willing to change yours? And sometimes it takes working through a lot of the ideas that are, in the study of cults, they call them thought-stopping devices, where there are things that you're taught in these situations, like doubt is bad. Don't doubt, doubt is evil. Doubt safeguards us against a lot of con artists, a lot of people who would take our lives, our health, our money, our everything. It's important to be able to shine a light of skepticism on things. And if you can, maybe instead of just addressing the thing that you disagree on first, work through with them that like, it's okay to question, it's okay to doubt. Like if God does exist and gave us a brain, he would want us to use it to think, to explore the world that he's created. If truth withstands scrutiny, we shouldn't be afraid to scrutinize and look under every single stone. And once they kind of get past that barrier where it's okay to ask questions and they want to go where the truth leads, then it's a lot easier to then start exploring a little bit more about these topics. I don't know if that helps at all. Any other questions? No? Are we at time? Awesome. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you, man. Thank you, Thomas Westbrook. Thank you. You can follow him on the YouTubes, Holy Koolaid. He has a lot of videos there for easy dissemination and learning about how to educate people. And keep an eye out for the Faithless Forum, which I think is being revived next year here in Texas. So stay tuned. As our musicians are going to give us one awesome song, as they're coming up now to give us that song, just want to remind everyone that North Orlando Oasis needs our help, and the links will be there. If they're not there now, they'll be up within an hour or two, ways you can help. Ways you can help us are in the back there, either whether it's monetary or signing up for a committee, which we do need help with kind of moving things forward, showing up early to set up, which wonderful people did today. Any way you can help, we absolutely appreciate it. This is all volunteer-run organizations. So in order to keep bringing terrific speakers like Thomas Westbrook, we need your help. And talk to Richard back there. He has a card reader. We have Venmo. You can talk to him about how to help. So one more song, and then I'll come back some rapid-fire announcements.
We normally, in Austin, I play a lot of covers. That's my job. So it's nice to do originals, but we are gonna do this one cover for you guys for our last song. Can you all hear the guitar out there? Okay, I'm not hearing the monitor. Yeah, okay, sorry.
All along it was a fever, a cold, sweat, hard-headed believer. I threw my hands in the air to show me something. He said, if your day come a little closer, round and around and around and around we go. Tell me now, tell me now, tell me now, tell me now, you know. Not really sure how to feel about it. Something in the way you move makes me feel like I can't live without you. It takes me all the way. I want you to stay. Want you to stay. It's not much of a life we're living.
It's not just something you take. Given.
Round and around and around and around we go.
Tell me now,
tell me now, tell me now, tell me now, you know. Not really sure how to feel about it. Something in the way you move makes me feel like I can't live without you. It takes me all the way. I want you to stay. Funny you're the broken one, but I'm the only one who needed saving.
It's hard to see the light, it's hard to know when one of us is caving.
Not really sure how to feel about it. Something in the way you move makes me feel like I can't live without you. It takes me all the way. I want you to stay. I want you to stay. I want you to stay.
Thanks, everyone. Really, really quick stuff. We have lunch. It's going to be in this handout here, but today it is at Jabastian's Mexican restaurant on Gessner Street. Address is on here. Deadline to register to vote is October 11th. If you have any questions, there's a couple of EDVRs here, and if you want to get more involved with other stuff, I'm your guy. I'm being very cryptic because Houston Oasis is not an activist group, so I have to... Blues Night is next month on October 13th. It's awesome, hosted by yours truly. Food Bank is Saturday, October 15th. Wonderful way to volunteer and help our fellow humans. Andrew Seidel book right here for sale in the back, and will be every week until he gets here. And when he talks on October 16th in 2 weeks, it's going to be a terrific talk. And again, don't forget to help out our neighbors at North Orlando Oasis. Have a terrific weekend. It's a beautiful day outside. Try to enjoy it. And we will see you all next week, which we start at 10:30 now. The official start from next week on is 10:30 a.m. So we will see you then. Have a terrific week, y'all.
And we did brew a little extra coffee. So if you missed out earlier, come get it. A little more coffee.